love the deep smokiness of that baigan in this baigan ka bharta. You know, there are certain times you place a dish in your mouth and you just want to be in that moment. You don't want to spend too much time trying to decipher what goes into that dish. That's exactly the sort of comforting dal makhani that this is. Bara kebab, the mutton chop. The meat is moist, moist and juicy. Hi folks, hope you're doing well. I can see dark clouds looming over us. So today we've stepped out not too far from where we are based in Bengaluru. We've stepped out to the neighborhood of Indranagar and we intend to explore this eatery that's been in the neighborhood for a while. And actually I was quite surprised to learn that this eatery has been around for the last 27 years. You know, that's the thing with neighborhood eateries. Because you see them day in and day out, they tend to blend into the neighborhood landscape. So you don't really realize that they've been around for that long. So the restaurant that we're going to today is called Treat. And I've actually tasted some of their food a long time ago, many years ago. I think I was at someone's place and they had ordered for some takeaways from Treat. So the other day I put up a post on our Facebook asking for Punjabi non-vegetarian recommendations. And this eatery came highly recommended. So yes, we do listen to what our viewers have to say. So do connect with us on social media, on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, LinkedIn. And keep us posted of what you would like us to cover next. So long story short, we're on our way to Treat to taste some kebabs and curries. Let's go. So the restaurant is open for takeout and delivery for the moment. Well, the mandatory temperature check and sanitization. Namaste.
Namaste. Welcome to Treat.
Thank you very much. So I'm with Mr. Pramod, who began Treat 27 years ago, and his children. So you are
Pallavi
and Karthik.
This is where we started 27 years ago.
Okay.
On 28th of April 1993.
1993.
Yeah.
A very different Bangalore then.
Well, to be very frank, we were the only restaurant on 80 feet road at that time.
Ah, okay.
This was the first commercial building which came up actually.
On 80 feet road.
These are all houses, huge 50, 80 side bungalows all around us.
Okay.
And no traffic, lot of greenery. It was so calm and peaceful and quiet during those days.
So what was a gentle, quiet neighborhood transformed into what we have now?
Absolutely, absolutely.
Right?
After I came back from the US, after finishing my graduation from there.
Hotel management.
My hotel management degree.
Okay.
I joined the Taj Group of Hotels in Delhi.
Oh, okay.
I'm basically from Delhi.
Okay.
So I joined Taj Group of Hotel. Taj Man Singh was opening up at that time in 1978. And I was number one role on F&B.
Oh, you were the first hire in food and beverage service.
Yes, absolutely. And worked with them for quite a number of years. And then happened to come to Bangalore on some business work of my father. And liked the place, liked the city. I said, why not chuck your job and start a restaurant in Bangalore? We started only with this place, with five tables.
Okay.
The tandoor as it is was here, kitchen was at the back.
Okay.
And then slowly, as we started doing business, we expanded on the ground floor.
But this is where it all began.
This is where it all began.
I did my hospitality from Singapore and I came back and I said, okay, now let's kind of, you know.
I've done my culinary arts from Heidelberg, okay. Culinary Academy of India.
Well, 27 years, this legacy has to be carried on.
It has to be carried on.
So they are the ones.
I think it's fantastic, not just in the fact that you have the second generation that has stepped up to the mantle, but the second generation has actually gone outside, studied professionally, and then come back to carrying on with the tradition in what is essentially, even today, a neighborhood restaurant.
Yes. We've had people who have dined here since 1993, 95, 97, or even 2000, and they moved away from Indiranagar or they moved away from Bangalore. Whenever they've come visiting, even Bangalore, you know, they've come back here. They dined here and they called me. If I was not here, they called me. The taste is the same which we tasted in 1993.
Hasn't changed.
It hasn't changed.
So where do these recipes come from, Pramod?
Most of the recipes are mine, of course.
Okay.
They're mine. My chef, even if he might change, a new guy comes in, but the recipes are mine, so I train them again.
You train them.
But fortunately, my people have not left me. My main chef, Raju, he has been with me since 2005. This gentleman you see standing behind you, he joined me in 1993 as a steward.
Okay.
And today he manages my restaurant.
So this, of course, is a makeshift kitchen for now.
Absolutely. This is the butter chicken gravy.
Ah, the butter chicken gravy. I love the color of that.
Yes.
The tomatoes.
And the Kashmiri chili and the kasuri methi.
And the kasuri methi,
yes. We grind our own garam masala.
Acha.
We grind our own wheat to make atta.
Acha.
So everything is done here.
So you know exactly what's going in here.
We have never bought ready garam masala from outside. This is the dal makhani.
The dal makhani.
And this has just been made. It was on the tandoor simmering the whole night.
The whole night. So once you switch off the tandoor, you keep it at an extremely low temperature and it cooks overnight. I like the fact that the vessels are stained dark, but these are stained dark from years and years of probably cooking that dal makhani. I think some of the flavors from the vessels too carry into that dish. What makes our signature dal makhani?
The byline of our dal makhani is, we know we do it the best.
Acha.
Why? Because we use milk to cook this dal. Once it comes from the tandoor, no water is added to it. We add milk to it.
Milk.
And it is cooked in milk until the milk is reduced, and that's the creaminess when you get.
And the dals, of course, are the kali urad.
The dal is the black urad. A certain amount of rajma in
it. Rajma hai usme.
And then we add 10% gram dal, the chana dal. And that chana dal is what gives you the thickness of the dal.
Ah, okay.
When we are cooking with milk, there is at least a kilo of butter which is added to it.
Of course.
Yeah.
Dal makhani.
Makhani, yes.
So there's the makhani, of course, is also the butter and also the velvetiness of it.
And the cream comes in at the last while garnishing.
Isme kya ban raha hai?
This is the mutton rogan josh.
So the rogan, of course, refers to the fat, the oil that floats to the top.
This is absolutely the Kashmiri chili color. And the rogan, we do not add oil to this. Jo, the fat of the meat.
Correct.
That is what converts into the rogan. See, rogan means the fat, what you're seeing there.
Correct.
Josh is the intensity.
Correct. Joshila.
Joshila.
You want the fervor of the spices.
The mutton is cooked in its own juices. There is not a single drop of water which is added to this.
You use stock.
We make the stock from the mutton bones.
Is there also some yogurt that goes into it?
Yes, rogan josh
has to be yogurt.
Rogan josh has yogurt.
So that has the moisture.
And it has fennel seed powder.
That's right. So it's a dish that looks fiery in terms of its intensity of spice, but it isn't. Because the Kashmiri chili lends more of its color than that aggressive spice on your palate.
Absolutely.
I'm certainly looking forward to tasting that mutton rogan josh. So kya ban raha hai tandoor mein?
Seekh kebab
bana rahe ho.
Mutton seekh kebab.
Aap kya use karte ho? Goat use karte ho? Sheep use karte ho?
Goat use karte ho. Yes. In my gravies also and in my seekh kebab also, I prefer using the leg. And we use about 10% of fat in the meat while mincing it. It is a binding agent also.
So isme kya kya dalta hai? You have the mutton mince, of course.
We have ginger, we have garlic.
Garlic.
You have green chilies.
Green chilies, of course, for a bit of that heat.
And we have some coriander leaves. I put some roasted cumin in it.
Okay.
Powder of mace, cloves, green cardamom.
Okay.
And nutmeg.
So this, of course, is a tandoori chicken, without which I think no Punjabi non-vegetarian.
The standard order by a Punjabi who goes to a restaurant is tandoori chicken, butter naan or pudina parathas.
Iske bina nahi.
And dal makhani.
So the tandoori chicken, I suppose, must be one of your fastest selling items.
Absolutely. I make sure, number one, the size of the chicken is correct.
Okay.
Number two, hand ground spices which we put in it.
Okay.
Especially the cumin and the mace.
And the mace.
And the right type of hunkered to be used.
The right type of hunkered.
Hunkered.
So what is that?
It is, see, hunkered, normally people, what they do is they just buy curd and put it in a muslin cloth and let the water drip. We, for the past 27 years, we've been making our own curd.
Okay.
We don't buy ready-made curd from outside.
Okay.
So the curd, when it sets here, when you open it, it's like really thick, you know. And then it goes into the muslin cloth. If it is to go in the muslin cloth for an hour, we make sure it is for an hour and a half. So each and every drop of water is
drained out. So on that note, I can't wait to get to my table and get a taste of treat. Well, I think this is the first here for Gourmet on the Road, sitting in a working kitchen and tasting. And of course, the fact that you can smell all the aromas, I can smell the aromas wafting out of that tandoor, and also of some of the dishes that are in those handis back there, definitely has more than stirred my appetite. I can't wait to taste some of the dishes here at Treat. What's also nice here is to take a look at, I think, one of the oldest menus. You have a full tandoori chicken for all of 50 rupees. You have a tandoori chicken half for 27 rupees. A kalmi kebab for the princely sum of 22 rupees only. You have a roti costing all of rupees too. When you see food priced in a manner as is, I guess that's why they refer to the good old days. Time to lower the mask. Well, I'm sitting in a kitchen here, so things are going to warm up a bit. But then when you've got interesting food with you, you don't really mind that. So this is the ajwaini paneer tikka. Of course, when it comes to Punjabi food, a kebab, you have to have a paneer with it. And this is a paneer tikka. And then we have the bharwa aloo. So what's interesting here is that they stuff the aloo with the cottage cheese, some carrots, some beans, and then they slice the aloo. So what you have really is a bharwa aloo that looks a bit like a pinwheel of sorts. And of course, some pyaz, the green chili pickle which is made in-house, and some mint chutney with some yogurt, I suppose. I think I'm going to make a beginning with that bharwa aloo. Let's get two pieces of bharwa aloo. This is a piece that I'm definitely going to enjoy, because you can see that this potato is charred nice and toasty brown in that tandoor. And even the paneer seems to have submitted itself to the heat, that 450 degree heat of that tandoor. Nothing like tasting aloo. The spicing is extremely light. You taste the aloo, you taste the creaminess of that paneer. A bit of the crunch that you taste from the vegetables, but spice-wise, it's extremely light. In fact, you barely detect any spice on your palate. This is certainly a dish that will benefit from some of that chutney. I can taste the zesty notes of the mint, the pudina in that pudina chutney. That now seems to complete things on the palate. You taste the zesty freshness of that coriander of the mint. I think there's also some chili that's gone into it. And of course, then you have that curd, the yogurt, the chilled yogurt that brings all the flavors together. So if you like your kebab mild, this is probably a kebab that you may want to try. But if you like it thoda damdar, help yourself to some of that chutney. I'm going to attempt a complete bite of this bharwa aloo pinwheel. Hopefully, I won't drop any back onto my plate. This is a chutney in that dish that elevates the flavors. So because I'm going to be tasting a few dishes like you would know by now, I think we're going to probably taste about 7, 8, 10 dishes, I don't know. I've requested for the restaurant to serve me tasting portions. And so we have that tandoori fish tikka that's also made its entry now onto my chef's table because I'm sitting here in the midst of the kitchen. Let's go for that paneer tikka. Oh, that paneer, even as I hold it, is soft, soft to the touch. I like the way the tikka paste is clinging onto the paneer and also has sort of caramelized burn in the heat of that tandoor. And you definitely have that hit of the ajwain, the carom seeds which you taste in that paneer. So on the outside you're tasting the marinade, the tikka marinade, and as you work the paneer on your palate, you're tasting more the richness of the paneer really than the tikka marinade. So when it comes to paneer, a traditional North Indian restaurant would always prefer to get its paneer from the north, from Delhi. I think the quality of the paneer there, perhaps because of the fact that it's made from buffalo milk, is always a lot richer, is always a lot creamier, and therefore lends itself to a flavorsome, creamy, rich sort of a taste on the palate. I think the paneer also makes for a good medium to soak up that fresh pudina hit of that pudina chutney. Let's go for some of that tandoori fish tikka. Ah, this is a sear fish. This is a fish that's flaking to the touch. I like the fact that the fish, despite being cooked in the tandoor, still has retained its moistness inside. You can definitely taste the seasoning in this fish tikka down to the core. You know, sometimes when you're tasting a tikka, you find all the flavor on the surface. And as you bite on it, as you chew on it, somehow the flavors seem to fade away. And that's basically a result of the seasoning, of the marination not having seeped into that particular meat or protein. But out here in this fish tikka, I'm definitely tasting the flavor of that, the tandoori marinade on top, but I'm also tasting the seasoning of the salt, a little bit of the lemon on the inside, which completes the flavors on the palate. And the fish is flaky fresh. There's none of that off-putting fishy smell that you may sometimes taste when the fish is not at its prime. I love the charred edges of this tikka. Gentle spicing, a little bit of the warmth that you get from the Kashmiri chili powder, a little tartness from the lime, some flavoring perhaps from the marinade, from the ginger garlic, and that touch of salt. That's all that you need. And it's also the sort of marinade that allows for the flavor of the fish, the sear fish, to shine. That fish tikka is so good that I'm very tempted to go for the second piece as well. I love the pristine white freshness of that fish. So comforting to taste a good tikka, fresh out of the tandoor a few minutes ago. I can feel my lips smack from the oil in that tandoori marinade. Well, we have some of the other kebabs that have made it to the table after that bharwa aloo, ajwain paneer tikka, and that tandoori fish tikka. So we have the prince of Punjabi North Indian kebabs, the tandoori chicken. And this is a quarter portion here, so I've asked for smaller tasting portions. Keeping company to the tandoori chicken is the kali mirch tikka. So this, I'm told, is a malai tikka with a marinade with a coat of freshly crushed black pepper. And then we move on to the mutton, to the meat. And here we have the bara kebab, the chops, the mutton chops. And this is a dish that I'm looking forward to tasting. I haven't tasted a good Sikh in a very long time. But I think we should make a beginning with that tandoori chicken. I love the color of this bird and also of that char. So this is the thigh and the leg. And typically the thigh will always have a little more fat. If you want a juicy piece of chicken, always go for the thigh. What's nice here is a gentle spicing of that kebab. You know, you want the spicing of a kebab to basically complement the meat or the protein. you definitely have a bit of the warmth from the spices, from that chili, some of that flavor that seeps in through the ginger garlic marinade, and a bit of that slightly pungent spike of the mustard oil that the chicken is marinated in. Now this chicken is cooked perfectly down to the bone. It's juicy all the way down to the bone. Also the kind of meat that lends itself to being torn on the mouth like this. Also I have a bit of the cartilage that I bit into, which has its own crunch. I love these charred bits. The charred bits give it a slight bitterness, which is always nice. A little bitter around the edge. You know, this is the sort of tandoori chicken that you want to get to every crevice of this bone and peel out all traces of meat, of cartilage that has been coated in that tandoori masala. The chicken is flavorful down to the core. So when it comes to tandoori chicken, there's actually two marinades that go into it. So you do a first marinade of ginger, garlic, some salt, and you let the bird be. And then you take the bird, squeeze out all moisture, and then you introduce to it the second marinade, which has its base in mustard oil and some of the spices, the Kashmiri chili powder, the hung yogurt that goes into it. And that's the second marinade that the tandoori chicken is allowed to rest in for some time. And that allows for the flavors to seep into the bird. So despite the fact that the tandoori chicken is cooked in a tandoor at 450 degrees centigrade, it's charred on the outside, but it's nice and moist. Moist and juicy within. They wanted to know if I wanted my place changed, but I said, you know, when you're eating, lagna chahiye ki aap khate peete ghar ke ho. I mean, it sounds a little corny, but the way I say it. But let's go for that chicken kali mirch. And the kali mirch is basically the pepper. And before I go for that, I think I'm going to help myself to some of that onion. The pyaz. So when you're eating kebabs, you want to eat ample amount of the pyaz in between. The pyaz is strong, of course, in terms of the flavors that it leaves behind, but that juicy bitterness of the pyaz also helps cleanse your palate, in a manner of speaking. So all that I tasted in the tandoori chicken has now been wiped clean by that onion. You bite into the full-on grainy textures and bold flavors of that kali mirch, or that pepper. I think if you like it spicy, if you like something that almost numbs your palate, that kali mirch chicken tikka is definitely something that you want to taste. I'm waiting for the flavors of the pepper to ebb away to allow me to taste a bit more of that malai chicken marinade. But that pepper refuses to play second fiddle to any of the other possible flavors on that tikka. You know, kali mirch, especially if it's freshly crushed, it's quite bold in its flavors. It's not the sort of ingredient, especially if you use it in copious amounts, to allow any of the other ingredients or the spicing that would have gone into that kebab to coexist. That kali mirch wants to do a solo act on your palate, and that's what this kali mirch chicken tikka is all about. In fact, after tasting that kali mirch, I definitely need some more of the onion to quell that numbing heat on my tongue. I think on that note, we're going to go for that Sikh kebab. You know, when you're tasting a Sikh kebab, you want that mince to be a bit coarse. You know, you want that keema to be a little thoda mota. You know, you want to basically taste the granular quality of the meat. Which you certainly do, along with the adrak. There's a fair bit of ginger too that goes into that Sikh kebab. You know, the Sikh kebab is a simple kebab, but for some reason, it's a kebab that many eateries struggle to get right. In most places, perhaps the meat is ground too fine, so the kebab ends up being pasty rather than granular. And what you also need is a bit of fat in that Sikh kebab. Not too much, because if you have too much fat that goes into that kebab, it ends up becoming more like a kakori. You want a bit of fat that just moistens your palate. I wish I had tasted this kebab even before I tasted that tandoori chicken, because as the kebab cools down, And typically when I'm shooting an episode, I've got all this food in front of me. I've got to shoot B-rolls of each of the dishes. So sometimes the dish tends to suffer a tad for no fault of the dish. I think that's what happened to a certain extent to this Sikh kebab. That fat in this kebab has congealed a wee bit. So the fat is molten when it's in the tandoor. And you have that window of opportunity for perhaps about 10 minutes, 5 or 10 minutes, as soon as it gets removed from the tandoor. And that's when you're supposed to enjoy this kebab at its prime. You know, the Sikh kebab is a dish that takes me back to my Bombay days, where we would roll the Sikh with some pyaz, with some mint, maybe some coriander, and make a nice happy roll and just munch on it. The Sikh kebab is not a delicate kebab. It has no nazakat like a kakori kebab. There is no romance to it. It's a sort of kebab that's a hearty kebab. It's a kebab that's meant to please you, bas, aur kuch nahi. And it doesn't mind being straddled with some pyaz, some pudina, some coriander. All that you need is a bread to wrap it up in. That fresh hit of that coriander and chase it with some mint. You're gonna go for that moist, definitely juicy bara kebab, the mutton chop. That meat is moist and cocooned still in a fair bit of the fat, and that meat peels away almost effortlessly from the bone. You know, when it comes to mutton, I want the spices to not coexist, but I want the spices to lend a distant supporting act to the flavor of the meat. Because when it comes to mutton, you want to taste the flavor of that mutton. You want to taste the flavor of the fat that lends it that unctuous mouthfeel. I like the fact that this bara kebab peels away gently from the bone, but the meat hasn't become a pasty mush. So sometimes the meat is tenderized a bit too much, it loses a bit of that bite. And when you're tasting meat, when you're tasting mutton, you want a bit of that bite. The meat is moist, moist and juicy. So I'm told I treat the marinade, the mutton chops, for a good 24 to 36 hours without any tenderizer. So which helps break down the meat, but also ensures that the meat is not a pasty mush. Well, I'm done with my tasting of the kebabs. Time to taste the main courses here. Well, the restaurant seems to be getting busy, so there's a hustle of activity in the kitchen, and we also have our main courses on the table here. So what do we have here? So we of course have that dal makhani. You can't miss the butter and that cream. Makhan aur malai marke with a green chili on top. And staying with a vegetarian, where would a good Punjabi meal be without the bharta, the baigan da bharta? And that's what we have here. And then you have the palak paneer. I love the julians of ginger that you see on top. And then we have our butter chicken, the murg makhani. Not with the chicken tikka, with the tandoori chicken, with a generous drizzle of that malai and also of the butter. After all, it's a butter chicken. And this is another dish that I'm looking forward to tasting. This is the mutton rogan josh. And then of course you have this bread basket, assorted rotis, I think the cocktail size. So there's a bunch of rotis here. This is the hari mirch paratha. This is the pudina paratha. This is a pudina or lal mirch paratha. You also have a naan somewhere here, a butter naan. And then you have some of the other breads. Well, I'm going to make a beginning before I get to the meats, before I get to the mutton and the chicken. I think I'm going to make a beginning with that palak paneer. I'm going to taste it with a plain roti. Let's go for that palak paneer. That paneer is soft. You know, the mild and gentle flavors of the palak, the spinach, find the perfect partner in the creaminess of that paneer. You know, I tasted the same paneer in the ajwaini paneer tikka, but as the paneer cooks in the tandoor, that tandoor also drains out a bit of that moisture of that paneer. In this, the paneer is absolutely soft and creamy. And the only bit of heat coming from the ginger julienes that have been sprinkled on top. I love the velvety texture of the palak. Let's taste the baigan da bharta. I love the deep smokiness of that baigan in this baigan ka bharta. The baigan is first roasted in a tandoor, cooled down, chopped, and then bhunaud, roasted with some onion, some tomatoes, and some spices in a kadai, in a pan. You know, the nuances of this baigan ka bharta, you discover bite by bite. When I placed that baigan ka bharta first in my mouth, I could taste the smokiness of that baigan, since the baigan is smoked first in the tandoor. And then I taste the sweet notes of the ripe tomato, and also the onions as they get braised and caramelized and break down in that baigan ka bharta. And then now I'm tasting the chili heat at the back of my throat. Although this dish looks gentle and harmless, it certainly packs a bit of a spicy punch. And that spicy punch is accentuated by the sweetness that you also taste in the dish. Because you have a certain sweetness in the dish, that accentuates the chili hit. You know, of course, you have all these other parathas, the chili paratha, the methi paratha, and all of that. But I just love tasting these dishes with a plain roti, because that allows for the flavor of that dish to shine just by itself. I love that baigan ka bharta. I can taste the warmth of the heat from the chili and also the ginger in my throat. That certainly is a warming dish. This baigan ka bharta is almost jammy in its texture. I'm enjoying it with my roti. But it's also the sort that you wouldn't mind slathering over some toast. That's how delicious this baigan da bharta is. You know, it's a humble dish, it's a simple dish. I love the layers of flavor that are coming through this baigan da bharta. I have that lovely dal makhani to taste, but I thought we taste another equally buttery dish. Makhan lagake, malai marke sort of a dish, the butter chicken. So when it comes to the butter chicken, there are two schools. One school uses a tikka, but the traditionalists always use the tandoori chicken. And typically the butter chicken came as an invention because you had some tandoori chicken, some tandoori kukad that was lying around. So the next day, an enterprising cook decided to put that tandoori chicken to good use. So he tossed up a gravy with plenty of tomatoes, and to that he introduced that tandoori chicken. And therefore, you have the birth of this glorious dish that has since traveled far and wide, the butter chicken. If you ask somebody about Indian food in any corner of the world, the one dish that they will definitely know is a butter chicken. Go with some hot roti with that butter chicken. I want to taste the gravy first, just with the roti. So you have the sweet acidity of the tomatoes. What's important to a good butter chicken are ripe tomatoes. Because if you don't have ripe tomatoes, that can give that butter chicken a slightly sour edge. Of course, people also balance the butter chicken gravy with some sugar, with some honey. But then if you have ripe tomatoes that do the job, you don't need any of that. What you taste in the butter chicken gravy is the ripe acidity of the tomatoes, the depth of flavor that come from the spices that are roasted along with a little bit of onions before the tomatoes are introduced to the mix. And then of course there's plenty of butter that goes into it. After all, it is the butter chicken, it's the chicken makhan wala. And then that tomato gravy is blended to this silken chicken makhani gravy. So the makhani is both about the butter and also about the silken texture of the gravy. And then to that gravy is added more butter. Of course the tandoori chicken, traditionally a day old tandoori chicken. And then it's finished with plenty of kasuri methi, some ginger, and a drizzle of cream just before the butter chicken makes its way out to the customer. That's a classic butter chicken. Let's now get to that chicken. Mm. You know, the flavors of the tandoori marinade that I tasted in the tandoori chicken a short while ago are now cocooned in the buttery tomato notes of that makhani gravy. What also happens is the tandoori chicken is cooked in the gravy. Towards the end of the cooking of the butter chicken, it also releases some of its spices into the gravy, into that makhani gravy. So there's a healthy exchange of flavors. The tomatoes in that butter chicken mollycoddle that tandoori chicken, lend it a certain gentleness in terms of flavors, and that tandoori chicken shares some of its tandoori marinade, some of its masala with that gravy. This chicken is cooked perfectly all the way down to the bone. Let's move next to the dal makhani. And this is a dal that's cooked in the tandoor overnight. It's cooked slowly over a few hours and then topped with some cream, some butter and some adrak. Not to forget the green chili if you like to spice things up. I think I'm going to taste the dal just by itself. You know, there are certain times you place a dish in your mouth and you just want to be in that moment. You don't want to spend too much time trying to decipher what goes into that dish. That's exactly the sort of comforting dal makhani that this is. So I am told that the lentils here, the kali urad, the rajma and some of the chana dal, a little bit, just to give it that texture, are cooked slowly in milk. Slowly over a period of time, so all that you taste are the nourishing flavors of the lentils with a faint layer of some of the spices that have gone into it. I can definitely taste a bit of the cardamom that has probably gone to the pot as the dal has cooked, has stewed gently over a period of time. This is a dal that's as comforting to the palate as is a mother's embrace to a child. That's seriously how good this dal makhani is. The sort of dal that calls for a third helping too. A tiny helping though, because I need to shake myself out of this dal-induced stupor and dive back into that joshila mutton rogan josh. So the mutton rogan josh, although hugely popular in the north of the country, is a dish that they say traveled from Persia and then found its home in Kashmir before making its way to other parts of the north. And the rogan in that rogan josh refers to the oil, refers to the ghee, refers to the fat. So there are various schools. Some say the rogan refers to the oil or the ghee that the spices are first braised in before the onions and the meat is introduced to the kadai to soak up, to absorb the flavor of the spices. There's another school that says that the rogan refers to the fat of the meat that rises to the top of the dish when that mutton is braised gently for a few hours. And there's another school that also says that the rogan refers to a term that originates in Urdu that also refers to the red color of the dish. The rouge is another variation of that same word that also signifies the rogan. And then you have the josh. The josh basically refers to the zesty, spirited flavors of the dish. And I think on that note, I need to get to savoring this mutton rogan josh. That's the oil, that's actually the fat from the meat that rises to the top as that mutton is braised, as that mutton is cooked. I can smell the caramelized notes of the onion even as I ladle some gravy onto my plate. Before I get to the roti, I want to taste that gravy just by itself. There's a bit of ginger that's clambered onto the spoon. There's a bit of sweetness that comes from the caramelized onions. And I can also taste the flavor of some fennel on the palate. This is a dish that looks fiery from a color perspective. But it's a dish that's quite gentle on your palate. Let's go for the meat. That meat has a bit of a bite. It's not the sort of meat that melts away on your palate, But as you chew on that meat, it releases with every bite the flavors of the gravy that that meat is braised in. I love the caramelized notes of the onion and of course the warming character of the spices. You can definitely taste the edge of the fennel in this gravy. And the richness of the fat as this mutton is cooked over a couple of hours. The meat is cooked all the way down to the bone and it still has on itself a bit of the fat that will only add to the depth of flavor of that meat. You know, when it comes to the Rogan Josh, there are a few variations of this dish. So there's one variation of the dish which is supposedly found in Muslim households, where for the color they use the coxcomb flour and that imparts its color to the dish, whereas the Kashmiri pandits would focus more on the Kashmiri chili powder and do away with some of the onion and instead focus a lot more on the yogurt. So one very special dish with its many interpretations in the way that it is cooked and savored. But then like the same, all roads lead to Rome, and this is the Rome of meaty deliciousness. And I got a piece of meat here on the bone from the leg. This piece gave away a little more effortlessly on the bite, thanks to the gelatin that it's sheathed in. My fingers are a mess. My plate looks like a tsunami hit it, but a tsunami of flavors. To be honest, I'm groaning after having tasted all those dishes, but when you see a plate that's as pretty as this and laden on it that plum gulab jamun, rasmalai and that moong dal halwa, how can you say no? I think I'm going to make a beginning with what I think will be the least sinful of the three desserts that are on my plate here, the rasmalai. Oh, that's a soft rasmalai. This sort of rasmalai that breaks down instantly on your palate, unburdening itself of that sweetened milk and leaving behind a wisp of that saffron, of that kesar flavor. And then the crunch of that pista, that pistachio. One down, two to go. I think next we're gonna go for the moong dal halwa. It's a moong dal halwa that's made with tons of ghee. The nutty flavors of the halwa that's basically braised in copious amount of ghee. And there's also a part of the halwa that's stuck to the bottom of the pan. And that provides it a bit of a crunch and a slight toasty edge on the palate, which balances against the ghee-laden flavors of this dessert. I love the moistness of all that ghee in this halwa. And then there was one, the gulab jamun, that plump gulab jamun. As I cut into this gulab jamun and I feel the resistance of that gulab jamun on my spoon, I know this is a gulab jamun that's going to be rich in the khoa. Rich gulab jamun, but I taste a bit of the oil. Well, I've certainly enjoyed most of the dishes that came to our table, from the kebabs, whether it was a tandoori chicken, to that fish tikka, and some of the other main courses that arrived later. What was very interesting also was that baigan ka bharta. Now, typically when you ask someone who's non-vegetarian about what he remembers of a meal, he would mostly remember the non-vegetarian dishes. But even as I come to the end of my meal after having tasted 7, 8 or 9 or 10 dishes, I remember the smoky complex flavors of that baiganda bharta quite distinctively. And of course, the other two dishes that I would definitely return for, the dal makhani and that mutton Rogan Josh. I think each of the dishes that we tasted here at Treat has made an impression on my palate. But I think what's most commendable is the fact that here's a neighborhood restaurant that's been a silent pillar of this community for the last 27 years. Open every day of the week, every week of the month, every month of the year, and catering to the community's craving for some hearty Punjabi fare. What to me is also very special is the fact that the founder, Mr. Pramod Chaudhary, came to Bengaluru 27 years ago after a stint in the hospitality industry, after hotel management in the US, to set up an eatery that would serve the Punjabi flavors of his home. And today he's joined by his second generation, his son and daughter, Karthik and Pallavi, who are now taking over the mantle, but after equipping themselves with professional qualifications in the space. I think for a city's culinary landscape to be rich, to be vibrant, it definitely needs more culinary establishments like Treat. Well, I've enjoyed my meal here. I hope you've enjoyed this episode too. Until the next time, stay safe, stay very, very safe, and happy eating. If you'd like to support the work that we do at Food Lovers TV, do consider joining our membership community on YouTube by hitting the join button below or on the homepage. You could pledge a nominal sum and receive special privileges like behind the scenes footage, shoot updates, access to live Q&As, and a lot more. You could support us on a Patreon page as well. For more info, check out the links in the description below. If you like this video, don't forget to subscribe, like, share, and leave a comment below. Happy eating!